rise, make your way to your seats, and rise with us as we receive the call to worship reading. It's from Psalm 71, 14 to 15. And it says, "As for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, of your saving acts all day long." Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this beautiful morning, another day of life that you've given, a day of life that you have provided that we can worship you and fellowship together, that we could sing your praises and just give praise and adoration to your name. You are a great and awesome God. And we do sing of your works. We recall your works day by day. And Lord, as we do, I pray that you would always remind us of your goodness and your faithfulness to us. So we thank you for this opportunity to worship and to fellowship together. And we pray that everything we say and do would bring honor and glory to your name. We commit this service to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's all worship and praise the Lord together, singing Cornerstone.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Sound. Only I then in him be dressed in his righteousness alone. Father, stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord.
Chosen and precious cornerstone. The one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Let's continue singing of his strength as we sing, A Mighty Fortress is Our God. Continue by singing of his goodness as we sing, God, you're so good.
Amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that
Father, you are so good. You are the ultimate Father, the ultimate leader, the ultimate person who should be feared and is so incredibly powerful, could crush us, could destroy us in an instant, and yet you considered yourself lower than us. You became a servant. You were so powerful. You show gentleness. You show kindness. You show loving and mercy. And Lord, we pray that we can have the strength that you have to be like you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. In a little while, we will have our greeting time. During this time, we welcome you to drop your offering in the offering box in the back of the sanctuary. We remind you that you can also give online or through the mail. Let's pray for the offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the gifts that we have received this week and in our lives. We pray that we could give a little back today and give it willingly, give it lovingly. We thank you for your sacrifice. And we ask that we could sacrifice a little bit of our stuff to further your kingdom. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all greet one another in fellowship. All right, let's all come back to our pews and let's rise and sing the family of God, because that's who we are. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain.
Okay, good morning, everybody. And again, welcome to Fardell Trinity Church. We're glad that you've chosen to worship with us here this morning, either here in person on this beautiful Sunday or online with us as well. And a special shout out to all the dads today and happy Father's Day. So, you know, thanks, dads, for all that you do. I know it's from first world experience. I know it's not always the easiest thing, but we have a great model in our God and Father in heaven. And what a model he is of his patience and his long-suffering and his power and his mercy. So dads, keep at it. Keep at it. Keep focusing on him and everything that you do, and keep raising those kids right. So we appreciate all the dads here today and all the effort that all the men in our church put forth in raising our church family up and growing him closer to God. So we appreciate that very much. Again, welcome to Fardell. We're glad you're here. Continue to follow us on Facebook and Instagram, of course. We also invite you to check out our webpage if there's any announcements that we make this morning that you didn't catch the full gist of, or you want to see what's going on at the church, or all of our summer programs are coming up. So we encourage you to check that out. One of the things that's due back today is the baby bottle boomerang. So these are due back today. If you haven't brought them back, please head home. Put them in your car so you remember them next week. Drop them by the church office this week. They will come to collect those, and they do even use the empty one. So if it sat on your counter for the 4 or 5 weeks, you didn't put anything in it, just bring it back, but hopefully full of change or a check for the Life Advocates Ministries. They run a number of pregnancy resources and family resources in this area, Hackensack, Hawthorne, in the general area here in Wayne as well. So we partner with them with this baby bottle boomerang, but make sure you bring those back if you haven't already. Also, we have our summer community service project. So usually, pre-COVID, we would take our youth group away and we take them to do a service project with an organization somewhere. So Boston or the DC area, Pennsylvania, we've been all over the place over the last decade or so. Last year we missed it completely because of COVID. This year we're dipping our toes back into the water. We're gonna go like knee deepish or so. And we're going to do service projects, but we're inviting the entire church to come out and help that week. So this is the week after July 4th, so July 5th through the 9th. During the day, we're going to be serving both individuals within our church that need help, as well as some of our local ministry partners and organizations that we partner with throughout the year to be a service to the community and a witness to the community this way. So we have about 4 days lined up that week. Not sure which 4 days those are, but Monday through Friday, 4 of those days. If you'd like to participate, just let Mike know. Just grab him on the way out today or drop him an email or give him a call this week. You can serve one day. You can serve all days. If you're available, we'd be glad and happy to have you. Great opportunity to do a couple of things. One is serve our community, which is what we're here for. It's one of the purposes of the church is to serve the community. It's also a chance to be a witness in our community. Through our service, through our love for others, we show the love of Christ. So you have a great opportunity to be a witness as you go out and serve in our communities. Both within our church family and those the organizations we serve with. And also, it's a great chance to fellowship. You get to hang out with some of the cool youth group kids, right? So you'll be able to come out. A lot of the youth group kids participate in this. You'll see other people from the church that you might not sit next to on a Sunday morning or sit next to in Sunday school or see them in one of the ministries you serve in. This is a chance maybe to rub elbows with somebody that you haven't rubbed elbows with before. So if you're interested, please let Mike know. It's coming up in just a few short weeks. And the more hands, the better. So we're happy to have everyone come out and sign up and help out if you can. At this time, I'm going to have Mike come up.
Every year at around this point, we like to honor and recognize our graduating seniors, those who are going to be graduating high school. And this year, in our church and in our youth program, we have 4 seniors who will be graduating high school. So we have Emma Robinson, we have Luke Giamanco, we have Brendan Notar-Francesco, and we have Grace Sansetta. And at this point, I'm gonna call Emma up to the front. We're gonna embarrass her a little bit, not too much, but just a little. And I wanna inform everybody where these seniors are graduating from and what college they're going to be going to and what they're going to be studying. Now, unfortunately, Emma was the only one able to be here today, so she'll tell you with her own lips. But as far as the others, I'll let you know that Brendan Notar-Francesco is graduating from Mahwah High School, and he's going to be going to Ramapo University. Luke Giamanco is graduating from Ramapo High School, and he's going to be going to Marywood University in Scranton to study architecture. And who else was there? Grace Sansetta is also graduating Ramapo High School, and she's going to be going to Rutgers University to study communications. And I'm going to call up Emma, and she's going to let you know where she's graduating from, where she's going to be going, and what she'll be studying.
Hi, everyone. So I'm graduating from Eastern Christian High School, which is a Christian high school in North Hailden, and I'll be going to SUNY New Paltz, which is a New York State school about like an hour and 15 minutes from here. It's so pretty around there, honestly, and I'll be majoring in communication disorders, which is helping people who have like speech issues or impediments or that sort of thing, like learning treatments and how to sort of improve from where they are. And yeah, I'm super excited for everything coming.
Excellent. So what we like to do in recognition of our seniors is also pray for them. And that's very important. We don't just pray for them now as we send them off, but as they go off to college and they're in college, we need to continue to lift them up in prayer. So let's go before the Lord and do that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for each senior graduating high school. Each of them have been a blessing to this place, a blessing to our youth program. They have served you faithfully in a number of different ways. They've participated and just been part of what's going on here, the life of FTC for so many years. And they've kind of like become our own. And so, Lord, as they go off, we're going to miss them, but we know that and we trust that your hand will continue to be upon them, that you would provide in every area of their lives. So we pray for them in their academics, that they would do well and succeed, that they would put the time and effort forth that's needed to do well academically. We pray most importantly for them spiritually, Lord, that they would continue in their walk with you, that they would make you a priority in their lives, that they would continue to serve you, Lord, that the foundation that's been established here as they've grown up would just continue, and that they would grow in their knowledge and understanding of the Lord Jesus Christ as they make their faith their own. So we lift them up to you, Lord, especially spiritually. We pray as well that you would guard them and protect them from the evil one who wants to take every opportunity to cut them down, to discourage them, and to bring them farther from you. But we do just pray that your work in their lives would be that much powerful and that much stronger. We pray that their faith would grow and develop as they make you a priority, as they're in your word, as they serve and get connected with Christians who can help them grow in their walk with you. So we lift them up to you, Lord. We thank you so much for them, and we commit their future completely to you. We love you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Emma, before you go, we have a card for you from your FTC family. Thank you. Into our sermon portion of the service, I encourage children 4 years old through fourth grade to make their way downstairs for All Kids Church. We also have All Kids Church for any child with special needs, 3 years old through 8 years old, downstairs running at the same time. And for us up here, I encourage you to open up your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 8. Before we do, why don't we go before the Lord in a word of prayer? Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for another beautiful day that you've given us. We thank you for this opportunity that we could devote this time to looking into your word, specifically to see what your word has to say about the day of the Lord. As we look at this, I just pray that you would enlighten us and that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit. We want to know the truth of your word so that we could live effectively for you as this day draws near. We commit this time and we commit ourselves completely to you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I encourage you to grab a bulletin. If you don't have a bulletin with you right now, I encourage you to grab one. If you have a pen or a pencil, I'd encourage you to grab one of those as well and take as many notes as you can. If you have your own separate notebook or some piece of paper you could find lying around, I pray that I encourage you to just fill it with notes today, because there's going to be a lot of information that I'm going to give you from God's Word about the day of the Lord. So if you remember last week, we looked at a portion of an end times event called the rapture. That's what we looked at last week. So Paul had to give information to these Thessalonian believers about a time coming in the future called the rapture. Now here in these verses, chapter 5, verses 1 through 8, Paul talks about a different period of time in the end coming in the future referred to as the day of the Lord. Now, about the rapture, if you remember back to last week, we saw a couple things. So we saw that the rapture is certain. We know that the Lord is going to come from his place in heaven. He's going to bring with him those who have fallen asleep in him, or that is the souls of those who have fallen asleep in him. And then we who are alive, we who are left, will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and we will be with him forever. We saw that the word, the phrase caught up in the Greek is harpazo or harpazo, and that means a strong gathering by God of his people to meet him in the air, to be with him forever. So we know it's certain because Scripture lets us know that it is certain. At the same time, we know it's imminent. That means we don't know the day or hour of Christ's return. We have to be careful about this, because there are many who have claimed to know the day and hour of Christ's return. I remember when I think we were first married, probably back in like 2007 or 2008, something like that, there was this man, Harold Camping, and apparently he had predicted the rapture of the church several times before, but back in about 2008 or 2009, he predicted that on May such and such, I think at like 5 o'clock in the evening, that the church would be raptured. And an interesting little story. I remember Kristen and I just happened to be out to eat at Chili's in Paramus, and they gave us a window seat. And I remember at about like 4:30 or 4:45 in the afternoon, it got dark. I don't know if anyone remembers that day, but it got dark. It was cloudy. Winds were like hurling. It was almost like earthquake, tornado type conditions and stuff. And we kind of joked and we looked at each other and said, could it possibly be? But anyway, we know it wasn't. And he had predicted the rapture of the church several times before, and he had been wrong. So there are many who have come declaring that they know the day and hour of the Lord's return. We don't know when that day or hour is going to be. However, we do know that it's certain. Remember, we said of these believers, even the Apostle Paul himself, that it almost seemed that they viewed that the rapture was going to take place in their lifetime, right around the corner, because Paul says, we who are still alive and we who are left till the coming of the Lord, we will be caught up together with them in the cloud. So it almost seems, again, that the Apostle Paul is writing as if he thinks that it's going to take place in his lifetime. Remember, in their finite minds, in their finite thinking, they don't understand and see time the way that God does. If they saw it across a line, right, they just see, okay, well, here are the things that have taken place up to this point that are pertinent. Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus rose from the dead, so the next thing that needs to take place as far as end times go is the rapture. They didn't know how much time would elapse between the resurrection of the Lord and the rapture. They thought it was going to be in their lifetime. So these are some things about the rapture that we looked at. Lastly, we saw that the rapture is like an instantaneous event. It will happen in a moment. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, it'll happen in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, that we will be changed and transformed. He says there in 1 Corinthians 15 that the mortal will be clothed with immortality. Now that's different from what we're talking about today, which is the day of the Lord. It's a different event. It's a different period of time. The day of the Lord refers to a period of time that is after the rapture, after the church is raptured, up until the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's a much longer period of time. Again, the rapture is instantaneous. The day of the Lord is not. It's a much longer period of time. We could say at least 7 years, because we know that the tribulation period will be a period of about 7 years. So with that said, let's open up our Bibles and let's see what Paul has to say about the day of the Lord and the hope that we have for what's to come in the future. Paul says, "Now, brothers, about times and dates, we don't need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come upon them suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers, are not in darkness, so that this day should not surprise you like a thief. You are all sons of the light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet." So pertaining to the day of the Lord, we know first, right off the bat, that Paul is writing about a different event here. Again, in 4:13 to 18, Paul was writing about a day in the future referred to as the rapture, the coming of the Lord to bring believers who are left on earth to be with him forever in heaven. This is a different event, and we know that there's a shift here. We know it's a different event because Paul says that in chapter 5, verse 2. He says, "For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." So Paul, in 5, 1 through 8, is talking about a different event, a different period of time in the future, again referred to as the day of the Lord. And one of the things that Paul says right off the bat in verse 1 is that about the dates and the times, we don't need to write to you. We don't need to concern ourselves with these small, minute details. In fact, if we are going to try to concern ourselves with these small details over when and how all of this is going to take place, we're going to end up frustrating ourselves. Because it's Jesus who said in Matthew 24 that no one knows the day or hour of the Lord's return, not even the angels in heaven, not even Jesus himself, only God knows the appointed time. There was another occasion when Jesus was talking to the disciples right before he ascended into heaven. You could read about this in Acts 1, where they were talking about what was to come in the future. And Jesus said, again, you don't need to concern yourselves about these details. Specifically, Jesus said in Acts 1:7 that it's not up to you to know the dates and the times that the Father has set by his own authority. So if we try to determine the dates and the times of the Lord's return and all of these things, we're going to end up frustrating ourselves because we can't know. Here's something else that we've looked at. If we try to concern ourselves with all of these specific and minute details, consuming ourselves with all of this information, well, then we're likely to live an unbalanced life, just like some of these believers were. Remember back in chapter 4, verses 9 through 12, Paul confronted some of these believers about living an unbalanced life. They were idle. They were lazy in their work because they were putting so much stock, so much attention and energy in what was to come in the future that they were neglecting their day-to-day responsibilities here and now. Well, we could learn something from that. We need to be the kind of Christian, right? Do be the kind of Christian who sees and hears and is able to discern the coming or that this day is drawing near. And do be the kind of Christian that tries to connect the dots, right? You see and you hear certain things taking place in the world today, and you're informed on the Word of God, and you seek to make those connections based on the Word of God. But don't be the kind of Christian like some of these believers were, who consumes themselves so much with what's to take place in the future that they neglect their day-to-day responsibilities.
Right? Remember, God has called you to a specific plan and purpose here and now, that you would bear witness to the work of Christ in your life, that you would reflect him, and that you would live in a manner that pleases God as you look forward to the day of the Lord's return. So do look forward to it with great anticipation, because you know what it's going to bring for you if you've trusted Jesus as Savior. But don't get caught up in all of the minute and specific details surrounding these events. Now, the day of the Lord is something that's mentioned in Old Testament and New Testament passages alike. And it's a time, when you read about it in Scripture, it's a time that involves both judgment and blessing. Right now, remember, this time period begins right after the church is raptured. And right after the rapture of the church, God is going to begin to pour out his judgment here on earth like never seen before. And all of creation, that is the physical universe and all people in it who are left, are going to experience this judgment, this wrath of God, because of their sin and wickedness. So it's a time of judgment, but it's also a time of blessing. For the church that's raptured, right? For us, the church that's raptured, we're going to return with the Lord to dwell here on earth forever, entering into the millennial kingdom. That will be a blessing for us. For those who trust Jesus as Savior during the 7-year tribulation period, it will be a blessing for them, because they too will enter into the millennial kingdom when Jesus returns. So it's blessing for those who have trusted Jesus as Savior. It's judgment and wrath for those who continue to stand in opposition to God and reject him as a way to salvation. Now, please understand Scripture. 2 Peter chapter 3 lets us know that the Lord Jesus is slow and he's patient in coming again, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to eternal life. We are given up until the Lord's return to come to a point in our lives by the grace of God that we awaken spiritually, recognize our need for a Savior, and turn to him for deliverance from sin's power and penalty. But once Jesus comes again, that time is up. So we do know that the day of the Lord is coming, and it involves both judgment and blessing. The day of the Lord is a time where God will be at work in world affairs more directly and dramatically than he has since Jesus' earthly ministry. Now here, if we were to just look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 8, Paul doesn't give as much detail about the day of the Lord as he did, for example, with the rapture. It seems that Paul needed to give them more information about the rapture. Maybe they had more questions, maybe they had more concerns, maybe they weren't as informed, and that's why he says, I don't want you to be ignorant and uninformed about these matters. Here now, though, if you look, for example, at 5, 1 and 2, Paul says, brothers, about the times and dates, we don't need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come. So it almost seems as if Paul had given them previously maybe more information about the day of the Lord than he did about the rapture. So when we look at this section, you don't see much detail and information about the day of the Lord. So I thought it helpful and beneficial for us if, in order to gain more information about the day of the Lord, we look at Matthew 24. If you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn to Matthew 24, and I've picked out three chunks of verses that I thought were important verses to read involving the day of the Lord. Here's the first one, Matthew 24, verses 4 through 8. It says, Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. Now, if we just stop right there, what's happening is that Jesus and the disciples had discussion about what was to come in the future. And the disciples asked Jesus, how can we discern that these times are getting near? Jesus said to them these things. This is how you can discern that the day that these things are coming. So Jesus says, many will come claiming to be the Messiah, and they will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed or surprised. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places, and all of these are just the beginning of birth pains, things to come in the future. This one here is Matthew 24, verses 12 through 16. Jesus says, because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. So when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation, spoken of through the prophet Daniel, Daniel 9:27, let the reader know and understand, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Matthew 24, verses 36 to 39, Jesus says this, but about that day or hour no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day that Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. So based on what Jesus says about discerning the times and being able to know when the day is drawing near, what I've done for you on the screen is I've highlighted several things, about five or six things that I want to draw to your attention pertaining to this day of the Lord and how we can discern that the day is approaching. Here's what Jesus said in Matthew 24, 4. If you look there with me, Jesus says, many will be deceived. Watch out that no one deceives you. Here's why, verse 5. Because many will come in my name claiming that I am the Christ, and they will deceive many. So I think a couple things are going on here, right? So one of the things that we could say, I think that is taking place as this day of the Lord draws near, and why people are being deceived, why quote-unquote Christians will be deceived, is because I think especially today, there has been and there still remains something like a lightweight, fluffy type Christianity, if there even is such a thing, if that's even Christianity at all. And why do I say that? It's because many pastors and preachers will come up to the pulpit, they'll speak through a microphone, they'll be broadcast all over the place with a false gospel, with false messages. They'll give a message about self and how Christianity and religion, it's all about me and what I could get for it myself, how I could produce my own faith. And how it's all about my wealth and my health and my happiness and what God could do for me, rather what I could do for the Almighty God. There are many false gospels and false teachers who are out there today. Another thing we could say as the end draws near, with this day of the Lord approaches, is that there will be a rise of false teachers. That was the case in Jesus' day. That was the case in Paul's day. It was the case in the Apostle John's day as well. And that's why John says, for example, in 1 John 2, that many antichrists have come already. These are false teachers. And John says about them, they have come out from among us. They're like sheep in wolves' clothing or wolves in sheep's clothing, right? They claim to be the real deal, but when you listen to what they have to say, they're not the real deal, and they will end up leading many astray. Be careful, because in these last days, there will be a rise in false teachings. Jesus also said there will be terrible times. There will be trouble and hardship. Here's what Jesus says in Matthew 24, beginning at verse 6. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you're not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Folks, please don't be surprised. Please don't be alarmed when you read the news and you see all of the trouble taking place around us. We know that trouble is going to take place. Please, at the same time, don't be desensitized over all of the sin and wickedness taking place in our country and in our world. But don't be so shocked and alarmed over all of the sin and wickedness taking place. If you think of wars and rumors of wars, I mean, this is all part of the effects of the fall, isn't it? But Jesus' point is that as this day approaches, these will just increase more and more. So we think and we look out what's going on in the world today, and we see the trouble taking place between Israel and Palestine. You think of threats from like North Korea and Russia and other places like this, right? We know that there are wars that we don't even know about because they're not broadcast. And rumors of wars taking place today. This day is approaching. But it's not just wars and rumors of wars that Jesus talks about here. He says in verse 7, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdoms against kingdoms. How about people against people? Aren't we seeing more and more of that today? Just right here in our own country, groups against groups, people against people. It's you versus me, based on what we believe or what we think. And today, so many social groups, so many social movements are being formed that are honestly causing division and divide in our country. I think they're set up with the attempt to cause unity, but all they're doing is causing divide and disunity within our country. Nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, people against people. And continuing, there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. And all of this is just the beginning of birth pains. This is just the beginning of the birth pains. This is how we could discern that this day is approaching. Yet, Jesus says, these are just the beginning birth pains. If you were to read Revelation chapter 6 through Revelation chapter 18, you'd see in full the judgment that God is going to pour out upon the earth after the church is raptured. It will be a period of destruction and devastation here on earth. And what you read in the book of Revelation is that through the judgment and wrath that God will pour out on the world because of its sin and wickedness, that God will make so clear to mankind that he is God alone, still with an opportunity to repent and turn to him for forgiveness, yet people will remain stubborn, unrepentant, and stiff-necked, and they will continue in their wickedness, continually rejecting Jesus as a way to salvation. Jesus says in Matthew 24:12 that in these days leading up to the day of the Lord, right, how we could discern is that there will be an increase of sin and wickedness. Look at what he says in verse 12. Because of the increase of wickedness and sin, the love of most will grow cold. Paul picks up on this as well in 2 Timothy, where he says to Timothy, people will no longer put up with sound doctrine, Timothy. They will gather around them a great number of people to hear what their itching ears want to hear in these last days. These last days, quite honestly, are going to be very similar to the day of the judges. Remember, in the day of the judges, it was this over and over again. You'd read, each one did as they saw fit in their own eyes. Truth is relative. Truth is what you make of it on your own. What's good for you is good for you. What's good for me is good for me. There's no absolute truth. That's what people will say. I'm the one who sets my own standard of right and wrong. Sin and wickedness will increase and people will continue to reject Jesus as a way to salvation. However, I love this. The gospel will go forth to all nations. The gospel will go forth to all the world. Look at what Jesus says in 24:14. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. I love that in the midst of the judgment, in the midst of some destruction and devastation that you hear during this time period, you also see a bit of God's grace extended to those who would trust him as Savior, right? The gospel is exploding, and the gospel is expanding. All you have to do is read the newsletters of our ministry partners to see how the gospel is expanding and going forth in all the world. I was just reading and listening to information about BOAM, Bible Open Air Ministry, this week. And you'd read about how the gospel is going forth in so many countries, in so many states of these countries, and people are coming to faith in Jesus as Savior. They're warmly receiving the Word of God and trusting Christ. The gospel is going forth at rates that are so much faster than decades ago because of the expanse of media and technology. The gospel is going forth to all nations. Matthew 24, 15 to 16, there will be the rise and the revealing of the Antichrist. Look at what Jesus says there in these verses. Matthew 24, 15 to 16. So when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation, spoken of through the prophet Daniel, let the reader understand. Let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Now the Antichrist is also referred to as here, and by Daniel in Daniel 9:27 is the abomination that causes desolation. He's also referred to by Paul in 2 Thessalonians as the man of lawlessness. He's referred to by John in the book of Revelation as the beast coming out of the sea. That's Revelation 13. And so what we know of the Antichrist, and this isn't like a message specifically about him, but briefly, what we know about the Antichrist is that he will be an end times ruler who will set himself up in opposition to God, right? Antichrist, opposition to God. We know that he's going to be given great power and some authority by Satan, the devil himself. When you read in Revelation 13, the devil is referred to as the dragon who will give him power. In 2 Thessalonians, Paul says he will be given his power by Satan himself to perform miracles and wonders and signs here on earth as never seen before. He will speak beautifully and eloquently, yet blasphemously at the same time. And that's why he will lead many people astray. We know that he will be aided by a person called the false prophet. That is the beast coming out of the earth that you read about in Revelation 13, who will require worship of the Antichrist, and he will establish a religious system. The Antichrist will set himself up in a rebuilt temple in Jerusalem, and he will require worship of himself. That there is the abomination that causes desolation. He will come promising peace. When you read Daniel chapter 9, you read that he will establish a covenant or a treaty of peace with nations that will last for about 3.5 years. But something will happen after about 3.5 years that treaty will be broken, and then there will be devastation and destruction here on earth as never seen before. We could say very lightly and loosely that all hell then is going to break loose here on earth. This is the Antichrist. In the times leading up to this day, he will be revealed and he will be on the rise. Then we read lastly in Matthew 24, 36 to 39, that these days are going to be just like they were in the day of Noah. No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day that Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. This is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. So what Jesus says is very similar to what Paul says, for example, in 1 Thessalonians 5:3, that people will be declaring and living in peace and safety. Everything will be good and everything will be just fine, or so they will think. They will go on living their own lives as if everything is fine, nothing is wrong, living their lives apart from the Lord, right? And they will believe that there is peace and safety. Peace and security. Their peace and their security comes not from the ultimate source of peace, which is Jesus himself. Their peace and safety partly come from the imposter who will be coming, declaring peace. But their peace and safety, their security also come from their own lives and what they've made for themselves apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. But it makes it very clear here in 1 Thessalonians, and Jesus makes it very clear here in these verses in Matthew 24, but little do they know that a flood is coming. Not a literal flood, but a flood of judgment and a flood of God's wrath. And it will be inescapable and unavoidable. They know nothing of this judgment because in defiance and ignorance they care not to know. But that judgment will come suddenly and swiftly, Scripture says, like a thief in the night. However, just as in the days of Noah, the offer and the free gift of salvation will be available and provided for those who don't know Jesus as Savior. Remember back to the days of Noah. They didn't know anything of this flood coming. That ark provided the salvation. The ark provided the deliverance, right, by God. And there was one way in, through the open door. Noah and his family entered and they experienced the deliverance and they experienced the salvation because they entered through the narrow door. It was available to all, but only those who entered experienced the deliverance and the salvation. Well, it will be the same in the day of the Lord. The offer of salvation is available to all, but only those who trust Jesus as the one way to eternal life will experience the benefits and blessings of this salvation. The day is coming. Jesus makes it clear that the signs are discernible. We can't predict the day or hour of his return. The signs are discernible. And just like a pregnant woman cannot escape labor pains, no one will be able to escape the coming wrath of God. Now, if we turn our attention back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, Paul goes on to make a distinction. And he says, but you, right? Because we've looked a lot about this wrath and how this wrath of God and this judgment will come upon people swiftly like a thief in the night. Well, how about believers? Here's what Paul has to say in verses 4 through 5. But you, brothers, are not in darkness, so that this day should not surprise you like a thief. You are all sons of the light and all sons of the day, and we do not belong to the night or to darkness. Paul once again makes a distinction. He makes many of these distinctions, not to set something up for them in their hearts and minds to say, well, here, believers, it's us versus them, or it's us versus the world. We have to be very careful not to fall into that kind of mentality. There is no us versus them kind of thinking. And it's not that we think or we get the mentality like we love each other, but we don't love those who don't know Jesus as Savior. What we're going to see in a little while is what Paul says in Scripture, that we too were just like them. We too at a point in our lives were apart from the Lord and rejected Jesus as a way to salvation. But God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive in Christ Jesus. And he drew us to himself. So we have to have the same heart and same mentality as the Lord Jesus Christ, filled with a burden for those who are lost, with love and compassion for them, that we seek to reach them with the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul makes these distinctions not to create divide. He makes these distinctions to remind the believers of their responsibility as those who have been called by God. So here's what Paul says. He says, those who are in darkness, that is spiritual darkness, are those who are apart from the Lord. They continue to reject Jesus as a way to salvation. They are without God and without hope in this world, and they know nothing about the judgment that is to come in the future. These are people who continually reject Jesus as a way to salvation. They're in spiritual darkness, and because they're in spiritual darkness, they walk and they live as such, in spiritual darkness, with no idea about the coming judgment that God is going to pour out on the earth. Here's what Scripture says. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. And then Ephesians 5, 8 through 11. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. So live as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists of all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. So they are in darkness, and they live as such. But Paul says, but you are not in darkness. You've trusted Jesus as Savior. You're children of light. You're sons of light, sons of the day. That means you have been enlightened. You've been awakened spiritually. You have been called by Him. You know Him. The Holy Spirit dwells within you. You aren't in darkness. You're in the light spiritually. You've been made alive spiritually. So now you can discern what's to come in the future. You don't need to be surprised over what's coming because you know what God's word says, number one, and you know you won't be here for the coming wrath. You'll be raptured. You are children of God. You are in the light, so we need to walk and live as such. Then we need to live in the light as He is in the light. Jesus says, this is a verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of the light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. And here's 1 John chapter 1. This is a message we have heard from Him and declare to you that God is light. In Him there is no darkness at all. So if we claim to have fellowship with Him yet walk in darkness, we lie and don't live by the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all unrighteousness. So there it is. But you Christians are in the light. You're alive spiritually. So now you need to live as those who live and walk in the light of the Lord Jesus Christ. So now what? What do we do with all this? I love when the passage itself gives the practical application. And that's what Paul does here. He starts verse 6 by saying, so then, or therefore. Now this is what we need to do. Let's look at what he says. Verses 6 through 8. So then, or therefore, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. For those who sleep, sleep at night. Those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. So now that we know that this day is coming, and we know that we could discern it's coming, the question then is, what kind of people ought we to be? Well, do we just sit back, relax, and take it easy? On a beach somewhere, with a drink in our hands behind our head, comfortable? No, we don't. Paul confronted the believers about this mentality. We don't just kick back and relax, knowing that we're good on this day. We have a responsibility. And here's what Paul says. Don't be like those who are asleep. The reference here to those who are asleep is different from the reference to those who are asleep in 4:13. In 4:13, we looked at this last week. Paul says, we don't want you to be ignorant or uninformed about those who have fallen asleep in Christ. We said that that refers to people who have trusted Jesus as Savior but have died. Here in chapter 5, I think it's verse 6, when he says, so then let us not be like others who are asleep. It's a reference to those who are spiritually dead. Don't be like those who are spiritually dead. You were spiritually alive. You were bought at a price. You have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you. You know Him. You've been called by Him. I love how Paul ties and he makes a connection between our calling and our position and our practice here. So since we've been justified, made right in God's sight, we've been called by Him, we have a responsibility to live for the Lord Jesus Christ in light of and looking forward to His coming. Don't be like those who are spiritually dead. Live as those who are spiritually alive. Be alert. Matthew 24, 42 to 44, Jesus says that. Jesus says, be watchful, be alert, be ready, because this day is coming. So the question for us is, are you ready? I mean, that's a question to think about. And I'm not asking, are you ready, you know, physically? Is your house in order for this day? Are your finances in order for this day? Are you spiritually ready? Are you right with the Lord? That when all of this goes down, that you're ready to meet your Maker. Be alert. Be watchful. Be ready. Be prepared. Be self-controlled. That is, maintain spiritual discipline. That is, be steadfast in your relationship and your walk with Him. Practice your spiritual disciplines more than ever before. Remain in God's Word. Right? Maintain spiritually disciplined and remain steadfast in your walk with the Lord. What Paul says here, look at what Paul says in verse 7. He says, for those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk, get drunk at night. Those who don't know Jesus as Savior are controlled by the sin nature. They're constantly giving in to their own sinful desires, pleasures, and passions. But that shouldn't be the same for us, right? We're controlled by the Spirit who lives within us. So we seek to bear fruit now, fruit that lasts. Paul makes a connection there, right? Those who get drunk at night, and that prevents them from responding appropriately to life. Just like someone who is apart from the Lord, who's constantly giving in to their sinful nature and their own desires, aren't able to respond appropriately to the things of God. But you be self-controlled. Lastly, you arm yourself. Paul would say in Ephesians 6, arm yourself with the full armor of God. See, what we looked at about the approaching of the day of the Lord is that there will be an increase of sin and wickedness. I think we're seeing that more and more today, aren't we? Christianity is being attacked, probably more than we've ever seen it in our lifetime here, and Christians are being opposed. Now, Christians have always been persecuted around the world, but I think today we're seeing more and more of this opposition from others to Christians because we stand for the truth. So Christianity is being attacked. Christians are being opposed. Those who are apart from the Lord want nothing to do with the truth. They're always going to seize the opportunity to cut the truth down and to replace the truth with a lie. However, we need to arm ourselves with the full armor of God. We need to be ready to take our stand, not only against the world, but against our enemy's schemes. Because he's our enemy, right? So we need to be ready. We need to take our stand on the Word of God. We need to speak His truth in boldness and in truth and with love. So Paul says specifically, we arm ourselves with the breastplate of faith and love. He uses the analogy here of a soldier. The breastplate was part of the armor that would protect from the neck to the waist. And it would protect all of the vital organs. Well, in the same way he says, let faith protect you inwardly, let love protect you outwardly. Love the Lord your God and love others. The two are intertwined and connected. He also says, put on the helmet of salvation or the hope of salvation as your helmet. You've come to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. The more you're in God's word, the more you appreciate what he's done for you savingly. The more you come to know and appreciate the hope and the assurance that you have in the Lord Jesus Christ, and that helps guard and protect your mind against the enemy's attacks. If we were to look at Ephesians chapter 6, we also read that we'd want to arm ourselves with the sword of the Spirit, take up the sword of the Spirit to extinguish the flames of the evil one. We need to rely on the Holy Spirit in all things, who goes before us. He equips us. He fights our battles for us and gives us what we need. Another piece of armor that Paul says in Ephesians 6 is that you would fit yourselves with feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. The gospel of peace. If you've trusted Jesus as Savior, you've come to know the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the gospel is something, the good news of Jesus Christ, who he is and what he's done for you, needs to drive and motivate and determine every area of your life so that you're not shaken by what's to come in the future or how your enemy seeks to attack you. But having your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace is not only beneficial for you as Christians, but it should be beneficial for those in your life as you seek to share the gospel with urgency with those in your life who don't know Jesus as Savior. Because if they don't, this devastation and destruction, this wrath of God is going to come upon them swiftly and suddenly like a thief in the night. So the question then for all of us is this: are you ready? Have you trusted Jesus as Savior? If you have trusted Jesus as your Savior, there's no better time now than to share the gospel with those in your life that you know and love who don't know Jesus as Savior. If you've not trusted Jesus as Savior, there is no better time than now to turn to him and him alone for forgiveness and cleansing from sin's power and penalty. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for these passages of Scripture that have an opportunity to shake us up and to kind of wake us up spiritually of things to come. We don't want to sit back idle and lazy in our walk with you, becoming complacent. We want to live for you. We want to bring honor and glory to you in everything that we do as we look forward to the day of your return. We want to bear witness to the work of Christ in our lives. So for us who have trusted you as Savior, I pray that we would live for you all the more as this day approaches. For anyone who's not trusted you as Savior, Lord, I pray that they would come to a saving knowledge of you. That you would just do a work in their lives. That you would draw them to yourself. Help them to see and understand their need for a Savior. Lord, we lift ourselves, we lift this day, we lift all that's to come completely to you. All of this, Lord, for your honor and glory and the praise of your name. We love you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please rise and join us in singing our final song, Our Father.
The words of Christ pass down through generations. Son of God, teaching us to pray. Echoed words, Father, have your way in me. Completely, we wholly trust your faithful in provision. Amazing grace, mercy for our sins. May we forgive the way that you've forgiven us, O Lord, so we can sing, Our Father, hallowed be your name, forever kingdom come, and in us let your will be done. Our Father, lead us from the valley of temptation. Deliver us from the evil one. Lord, you reign, and here we stand victorious. In your name, together we pray. Our Father, hallowed be your name. Forever our God be exalted.
Sits on the throne, and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Amen.